and then you look out, and you grab the ratlings, you look out.
I don't think any of us thought we'd be making another pirate movie. And then here we are today.
The camera guys are gonna hate us with salt water and all this shit. Right, so that the bones are lashed.
A year ago, we had a meeting at Bruckheimer's office just to talk about, okay, what do we, the very first, what do we do?
At that moment, when it happens.
How do we make this into two movies? What's the next agenda? Who's our bad guy?
This is Davy Jones.
Is he a bad guy?
Well, depends on really how you look at things. I like him.
It's always about the characters. You know, we only had 2 hours, or a little over 2 hours in the first movie to tell you about them, and now we got most probably 4 hours to give you a lot more depth into who they are.
Everything was on the table, Fountain of Youth, and just kind of every crazy idea. The concept of, you know, what does a trilogy need to accomplish? You have to feel like you've finished off. Nobody should make a pirate movie again after we're done, you know, the end of an era.
The War Room, welcome to hell. We don't have a script for either film, and it's October and we're shooting in February.
Everybody's eagerly awaiting scripts, we're working with the writers, and we're obviously working backwards from a release date, ultimately. We've got to have that pirate movie, and it's kind of nuts, and it's kind of fun.
How did you get to this point without a script?
Well, we don't have a script yet because I think when this whole idea of Pirates 2 and 3 was pronounced a go, the writers were plucked from wherever they were and given the challenge of writing the scripts in a very short period of time. And I think right now they're furiously closeted away in writing. They're just a little bit behind.
You see what I mean? And it just snaps, and the current just takes it away.
You know, that sets up a really cool thing, because, you know,
you don't want to give them the script too early, because then they make changes and stuff. You want to give it to them just a little bit of time. And then by the time the script is done, they, you know, have to shoot, you know, what's there. And it's actually a very helpful thing to not
turn in first draft, first day of shooting. That's the goal.
It's for their own good, really.
How the heck do you spell it?
We didn't necessarily think that the first movie was going to be successful.
Basically, we thought that not only was it possible we may never get to write another pirate movie ever again, it was also possible that no one would ever get to write another pirate movie ever again. So
the challenge of then doing two, which essentially makes a trilogy, is to give the appearance that the first movie was oh so cleverly designed to lead to the second and then to the third.
Exactly.
When in fact, at the time, it was meant to be a very complete thing.
Even if you just connect the
Because they've got a distance to run, right?
Because the script is not complete, Gore and I got together early and just said, we need to come up with sequences anyway. We have to figure out huge chunks of the script that haven't been fleshed out yet. So I'm glad if there was a finished script at the beginning, then you're just sort of, you know, painting by numbers. But I love it. You get to sit here, create a pirate story, and then somebody's gonna film it, you know? I mean, it's amazing.
This time around, like we did on the first movie, we scouted the Caribbean again thoroughly. And you start in Jamaica, you head east, and then you take a right and head south. You have to understand, this is a Gore Verbinski film. The only way a location is going to get picked by Gore is if you have to swim to it, hike to it.
We're just coming to see your field there, buddy.
Rappel into it or parachute into it. The more extreme and remote, the better it is.
We've lost our minds. We've lost our minds.
It's like a little child in Gore, even though he's a real tough, smart director. But he's got that little kid inside of him, which gives you that smile all the time.
It was amazing. It was an adventure every day, where everyone was exhausted but exhilarated. The swimming and the hiking and the boating and the helicopter rides.
We're trying to find new exciting locations, and that's the only way to find them. What's down that road, you know, and start hiking. Right. What's up that hillside? Wait till you see the Cannibal Island location. It's extraordinary, but the only way we found it was with a man in front of us with a machete cutting a path up the hillside for us to go explore.
On there right
now. Two mounds and a bridge between the two of them.
Our most interesting or challenging island is Dominica. One of the reasons we picked Dominica is they had a Carib tribe that were descendants of the early Indians who had settled throughout the Caribbean, and they had a look that Gore was interested in.
This is Gore, the director of the movie.
Hello.
And then as you lower the fruit,
I feel lovely.
Also, it became apparent early on in this picture that we were gonna need a tank. Because again, we have a lot more action that takes place on various ships and at sea and stuff like that. And hence, that's how we have ended up in the Bahamas.
In a few months to come, this will all be ours. Pirate ships, as far as the eye can see.
Yeah, 4 to 5 foot,
which you can dig out further.
I just guessed on this, guys. I put us out 70 feet high tide, and right now the tide's out probably halfway.
And that's just gonna give you 300 feet from this platform?
So when you pan around and have a look at what needs to be done to get this up and ready for an enormous shoot with an enormous crew and support, it's a little bit daunting at the moment to think that it'll be ready in time. I'm a little nervous.
Temporary script and then a shooting schedule. And we're kind of packaging it all together so that we can give it to them at the department head meeting.
I'm very excited because I've never been asked to do a 200-day schedule. I've often lied in the past and done a 97-day schedule that turned out to be 200 days. But here we are officially doing a 200-day schedule. And after 3 weeks of being involved in the project, this is all the information I know so far. There's lots of things that are missing from this because we don't have scripts yet. Mike, I apologize.
People felt like we had time and that, you know, the scripts would turn themselves in.
What we're looking at right now in terms of getting this draft is getting it written. I think in terms of just getting this draft written, That's kind of how we have to go.
I don't know. I mean, I suppose, you know, it was unrealistic to think we could wait this long.
I always thought that was something terrible was coming. In other words, panic. You come up on deck, everybody's panic, and there's nothing here. And it's like, you know, Gibbs.
Right.
Is he like, woo, and what's going on? Something terrible is coming, should throw to the crank and not to a wedding. That's the problem I'm having with that.
We can't figure out, in all honesty, Gore, we can't figure out, we need to write the wedding scene somewhat linearly so that then we can go back and change it into the non-linear construction you're talking about.
Can we continue in here?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, this was supposed to just be a real quick little, can I get the copies of the storyboards you have so far?
Okay. Marine?
The Black Pearl's moving along, if anybody is interested. We keep a timeline every week of what's happening as it's progressing up from being chopped down to built up.
We knew the need this time to have a practical Black Pearl.
We're here to just kind of feel things out.
Right.
And we'll come back again with our equipment and get set up, and it'll take 3 or 4 days to get the whole thing wired and set up and running.
The last time, we built a ship on a barge down in St. Vincent for the at-sea stuff with the Black Pearl. This time, we decided to buy a ship.
So these things all good?
Yeah, everything. I mean, we knew it was all up and going, but Terry and
we bought a work ship, basically for oil. It was at a Gulf boat, and it would service the oil derricks in the Gulf. And I think everybody's going to enjoy the results.
A sailing pirate ship, a diesel-powered pirate ship.
That's a $2 million.
Sorry, I forgot about this mirror. I got it on the other one.
This one. You go ahead.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Yeah. This is to get the road going up the hill at Cannibal Island. Beckett's office, which wherever we are, we'd like to do this. Claire's stories.
Build it.
Build it now.
Build it and they will come.
Yeah. We're all set?
Sure.
This is the start of it all right here.
Yeah, I'll play John. I'll have them. Johnny will slide down. He'll start running, working our way to the wheel. We cut to them. One, two, three shots later, the wheel breaks. So the wheel's path is being controlled by what? God, I thought it was going to be something where through the church, on the far camera side, there was something that came out, and that the wheel came into a track, and this thing came into a track.
Because Johnny's not going to be anywhere near an 18-foot wheel rolling at his head.
This is like a big erector set, you know? Eventually the stunt guys are gonna be running on top of it, inside of it. There'll be water going, it'll be spinning, and then it'll detach and start rolling down the hill. You know, there's like handrails and stuff and handles for them to hang on to. Just trying to make it as safe as possible, but making it look dangerous, you know? Huh. Movie magic, yeah.
Today, let's just do a little slower pace, concentrate on things. And I feel like we're just pushing for volume instead of quality sometimes. I'm still not happy because of the positioning of the three guys within the wheel. It doesn't lend itself to good choreography.
First thing up?
First thing up, we should, what do you want to start, inside or outside? Hey, Mark.
Yeah.
Peter Pan has nothing on you.
Why did you wait so long before you come back to me?
The scene's so bad you can't even blame it. I mean, she's trying.
Everybody tried.
It's like put a fortune teller sign and nail it to your forehead, and that's what I play. It's totally two-dimensional, as written.
Do you want to show this to them?
Yeah. Do we call them in right now?
Sure.
It feels like the curtains are opening and welcome to my... And there's more depth to what she can do.
Yeah, I'm not sure how to put this. That document was just to show that at that point there would be a scene about that long with approximately those characters. It was not intended to be...
read or informed.
Yeah, it wasn't intended to be read or informed.
But it is being read.
We knew that they were casting Tia Dama. We had written the scene that they were using as casting without the intention of ever having actors read it. It was really a placeholder scene for the purposes of scheduling.
What's there? We would have been better off just obviously typing all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy for 3 pages.
But what I took away from it was that Gore effectively conveyed the point that he was at in the process in terms of his need in a way that was much more stronger than it would have been if he just had said, you know, hey guys, I tried to cast based on that old scene and it didn't work. And rather than just telling us that, he demonstrated it by showing the casting session that essentially wasn't working.
And at the same time, even as he called us into that meeting, we were in here, in our office, writing the version that we wanted to actually have.
Did you tell Pearl yet?
I'm in the middle of it right now.
Okay.
Well, not now.
A lot of your stuff for you.
Thank you. This part, right here? No, I think this is kind of... that Tuscan villa kind of vibe. I mean, you should close those gates or, you know, watch the scene and figure out exactly what it is. And is there a bit of boosh bash boosh? Can I get Terry on the phone?
Ted.
My man. You can accuse me of being ye of little faith, but I just wanted to call you and say I really
I love it. Well, listen, thanks for putting in the little eyeballs and those details. I feel like the scene is fun. And it's gonna be a lot better hearing somebody say, you know, play it now. No, I'm relieved. Excellent. All right, man, I gotta go. I'll talk to you later. Thanks again, bye.
On behalf of production, I just wanna wish everybody and your families, please have happy holidays. It's gonna get busier after the first of the year.
At the peak of our construction phase, we had close to 1,000 people on payroll. We have the advantage here that Gore has a pretty loyal crew base, and it was great to get a lot of the crew that we had on P1 or is back for P2 and P3.
I just want to thank everybody for doing a great job and working so hard on this film. And I feel like this is about one quarter of the size that we will be next year. Thanks a lot. Have a good holiday, and look forward to working together.
Pirate's dice. It's different. Quite a different game.
Oh. I really did. Back to normal.
Do you know that I'm gonna have to call that?
Pirate time for us.
You think he's a liar? Is that
pirates? I think he's a pirate.
You're bluffing, Sonny.
Poker is one of those things that cinematically just always really works well because it's expressions, it's audience knowledge of the hand, it's strategizing, it's pure
character behavior.
It's character, yeah.
Here's the poker game. You show the guy, you know what everybody has, and you say, I'll take three cards. Then you don't show what everybody has. So you still have the reveal.
When he sells Will out, the other thing is he has to get 100 souls also, so it's two.
It's Will plus 100 souls, and then he's even.
So he's an escrow.
And
Will's an escrow.
So they only need 99 more.
Exactly.
Yeah, Jones 99. Is just...
Yeah, 99.
I know Gore has been playing this game incessantly with his kids in working out how am I going to shoot this game to make it exciting, but it's also a matter of how are we going to actually write the game itself so that the audience will understand at least instinctively what the game is without having to be told intellectually what it is.
As long as you understand the game. If you don't...
Let me just pitch something.
You got to understand the game, otherwise you're completely lost.
But we watched three...
Go!
The signals are working.
Hi, you've reached Sandy Lisa Casting and the Pirates of the Caribbean. We need extremely skinny men. You have to look like if you're taking a nap, you may have passed away.
Skinny, skinny, scrawny guys. Emaciatingly skinny.
These guys have to realize that they were chosen out of more than 10,000
More than 10,000 people. Gorgeous.
And we're picking about 150 to come in for the next couple days.
I want to rule the seas!
At our open casting call, we had thousands and thousands of people come in, and a lot of them had beards and long hair, and they think they're a great pirate, but most of them are just way too good looking.
To make the cut of the actual pirates that we're casting, you really have to have a little something,
right.
Something special.
I was telling people I want to be in this movie before they even announced it was going to be a sequel.
When my agent called me, she said they're looking for a bumbling and pathetic pirate. And I'm like, I've been training for that my whole life.
I'll tell you what the challenge is finding those guys that look that crazy in that caricature, and them being able to act.
And not being crazy.
And not being a nut. So, yeah.
We have a box of nuts over there.
Yeah.
Take this off. It's too much. They want you to look at it. Take this off.
This is a one in a million chance. I mean, and this is Gore Verbinski, who doesn't want to be seen by him.
So this is one of the guys is being dragged by two guards. So he's actually being held by two guys, guards who are dragging him. And what he's seeing as you're being dragged back is there are these skeletons in cages. And there's one or two that are barely alive. And the birds are coming in and picking this guy's eyes out. Okay, you realize that's what's gonna come to you. That's what's gonna happen to you guys.
What meeting is
we thought we knew.
This is the picture boat meeting and questions that the Marine has, that how it impacts with the art department and effects.
So, bit of a crunch week this week. Right now, it's the budget's really high.
How do we avoid shipping these all the way to Dominica? Wouldn't it be, isn't there a...
Wrong.
Yeah. Isn't there a smarter way of getting them there other than shipping them?
They give you numbers, and either you live by the rules, which is getting to those numbers honestly, or you don't. And if you don't, then, you know, everybody could be sent home, which is very possible.
Well, you know, if I take two waters away, I'm...
A lot of people think, oh my gosh, you're so far into it, they're never going to let this movie go away. Yeah, I think that's a dangerous game to play.
We're all sitting here slashing and burning. So we save 200 by not building the pier, we save 50 by not dressing the dive shop. Let's say we cut our distant location days from 400 to 375.
Okay. So you say 25,000. It's not
times 150 days.
Right.
Now what if you saved it by, what if you cut it by 50? So you'd save $7 million.
Right.
I mean, we have
the
to take
is how do we reduce day costs?
Here's the thing, what I'm getting at is we're a distant location movie.
Right.
There's
right.
No, that's never gonna change. We have to attack our day costs on distant location. We have to be a very small big movie on distant location.
They made it clear to me, make sure this is a real budget. We're only interested in your numbers, and make sure you're accurate.
It was almost over for Pirates of the Caribbean 2 and 3. They booked airplane flights for everybody that was out of town to come home. I had a job offer over the weekend here. People called and said, I hear your film's going down. Are you available?
Does anyone want a glass of wine?
You would have thought we'd be in better shape. But that's the movie business.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Let's come to order. So now, okay, so you all have a new schedule here. So now's your chance to ask your questions. Speak up or forever hold your peace.
Obviously, we only have 2 more weeks. We're very tight on our time, especially with Gore. Pretty much every day is completely filled up.
So, here's my girl. With a bunch of vines and stuff, you're gonna have to reach out and grab them. And probably the first time.
Yeah,
no, I'm right. Okay, we got a half hour to do storyboards, and I gotta go through these location photos, and then we're having a ship to ship meeting, and the gimbal doesn't work, and you know, we can't tip the ships to that degree because the cannon ports will flood, and you know, just everything, logistics, everything. We just need more time.
I don't know how Gore's holding up. He just sort of dismisses it and moves ahead. We're going to make this film, and he's just an incredible driving force.
Set deck, show and tell. We have that day as well. You have an hour there.
It'll be quick. Just want to show you some
stuff. No, I appreciate it. We're out of time.
Totally,
I
had to.
You never think you're prepared, but there's a clock ticking. We have a release date. You know, every second that goes by is like a taxi meter. It's ticking. The dollars are slipping away.
Flash, one coming down, dangling, and wrapped around his ankle.
Then Monday, Tuesday, day one and two is in that rum cellar.
We have a start date, and we're making this thing, and it's either going to be a complete piece of garbage or it's going to be fantastic.
Cheers for Charlie.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So this is day one of production. Day one of 200. It's very exciting.
Camera's moving. Let's just clear this bottom deck. Hands out.
Well, you can never really be prepped enough.
As you know, we've been struggling with sort of budgetary problems.
Shoot out pirate caves.
Get back on the boat. We have a box
there. Scheduling problems.
All right, so what if there's one shot of
script problems.
Well,
no, I think we could have prepped for 6 more months and still not be ready for the movie. So
But I knew we'd make it, and we did.
So at some point, the snowball just has to start rolling down the hill, and it's just damage control, here to the end.
Back on action!
Gore is storyboarded every sequence. He knows every location, he knows every shot he's going to do. He's really, on top of his game, so When you have a director like that, that's prepared like he is, even though he doesn't think he is at this point.
It feels like an old friend, you know? It feels like a glove, you know, or a hat. You know? Just as soon as we started shooting, it just feels like we're back. And we never stop.
Roll sound.
Action.
Action.
Action!
Action!
And action!
Ready, and action!
Yeah. Thank you.
Roll sound.
Captain Jack Sparrow. You made a deal with him too, Jack. You raised the bar for
him. That was great, Johnny. Let's try one more of those.
Cut! Cut!
Cut!
Cut!